distinguished alum, Paul Bogard, who's going to talk to us about the end of night. And he is nationally recognized in this field. He's published the End of Night, Searching for Natural Darkness in an Age of Artificial Light. And he's also an editor of Let There Be Night, a testimony on behalf of the dark that has also been published. He's a native Minnesotan, and Paul has lived and taught in Minneapolis, Albuquerque, Reno, northern Wisconsin, and Winston-Salem. He's a graduate of Carleton College and also the University of New Mexico. He has a master's degree in creative writing from here and the University of Nevada, Reno, where he has his PhD. He's now an assistant professor at James Madison in Harrisonburg, Virginia, and he teaches creative writing and environmental literature. So you'll see his web address on there for those of you that are interested in knowing more. But without further ado, please welcome Paul Bogard.
Really want to thank you for being here tonight. It's great to have you here, and also want to say thank you to the UNM Alumni Association for having me come, and especially to Kim Feldman, who has really was the point person for inviting me and has been so kind to me since I've been here. So thanks to Kim and everyone here. I've been here less than 24 hours. I got in late last night. Which I'm sure you know means that I've already been to the frontier, La Matanita Co-op for a breakfast burrito and Barella's for lunch. So if you see me holding my stomach at any time this evening, you know it's because I've done my usual green chili, red chili binge anytime I come back to New Mexico. I love coming back. It's being on campus brings back a lot of memories. I can't believe I graduated in 2003 and moved to Reno, and since then you heard some of the journey since then. I can't believe it's been that long. I know you all know how that is, but it's really nice to be able to come back and see the sandias and go down by the river and come onto campus and just to be here again. So it's nice to be here. This book that actually came out in hardcover in 2012 and paperback in 2013, and then the last couple, 2 or 3 years, I've been traveling all over giving presentations, and it's been a real pleasure. It began here. It really began, my interest in writing about night began when I was in the master's degree program in creative writing, working with Sharon Warner, who's here tonight, and Greg Martin, and others. I began writing about this beautiful time and place that we call night. And gradually, I remember this was in the olden days, and Borders was still open over in Winrock Mall. And I would go over there on Friday nights because I had no friends. And I would, I remember sitting in the aisle in the astronomy section with these books all around me, just reading everything I could about astronomy and trying to learn about this subject of night and darkness. And since then, it's been quite a journey. I've gotten to go to some really wonderful places. But New Mexico is a special place for me and a special place for darkness, for nighttime. It is one of the resources that you all have, all of you New Mexicans and all of us who love this place. And I guess I'm sure I'll talk about this more as we go through the presentation, but it is a resource that if we want our kids and our grandkids to have, to enjoy it like we've enjoyed it, we'll need to pay attention to the lighting, the way we're lighting the night now, or we'll lose this resource even here. So. What I'd like to do tonight is to read a little bit from the book and to show you some images, both of beautiful night skies and then also lighting, which can be beautiful and not so beautiful, and talk about what we can do about it. And then I'm very happy to answer questions afterwards. We'll have plenty of time for that too. So, The End of Night is not a book written by an astronomer. It is a book written by an English professor and a storyteller. It's a book of stories, really. It has a lot of science. It has a lot of information, research. But primarily, it's story after story of me talking to people about this subject and getting to go to some really interesting places. There's one chapter that starts off with a trip to Chaco Canyon, for example, and I tell a story about being out there. But the first story that I tell, and it's one of my favorites, is the story of going to upstate New York to meet with a guy named Bob Berman, who's a longtime astronomy writer. And Bob is a kind of a big, gregarious guy, and he's known for his sense of humor. And he writes about as often as he can with a sense of humor about astronomy, which, as he told me, isn't the easiest thing to do. But he said, I asked him what his favorite piece of writing was that he'd done. And he said, without a doubt, it's the article I did on all the dumb questions I've been asked over the years about astronomy. And so I bit, of course, and I said, well, what's the dumbest question you've ever been asked? And he said, it's hard to top if a solar eclipse is so dangerous, why are they having it? But I also really like, does Mars have a sun like our sun? It does. Bob took me out to his, what he called his do-it-yourself observatory, which is a fairly large telescope and in a observatory he had built. And the moon was out that night, so we looked at the moon. And then he turned the telescope to something else, and he said, look through this. Look through this now. And so I stepped up the ladder and looked through there, and without even thinking about it, I said, oh my God. You know, just kind of a natural, like, wow. And he laughed and he said, it was Saturn, right? It was Saturn through a telescope with the rings and just as crystal clear as you could see. It took my breath away. And Bob said, I've shown that to more than 1,000 people through this telescope. And they always say one of two things. They always say either, like you did, oh my gosh, you know, or they say, that's not real. And he's even been accused a few times of somehow putting a photograph of Saturn in the telescope. And we got to talking about how, why is that? You know, why would people be so surprised to see with their own eyes one of the planets in the solar system? And it really came down to this idea of we've lost touch with nighttime, with the night sky, with darkness, with night in general. It used to be something with which we were very familiar. And I can look out and see people of a certain age, and I think you probably had firsthand experience with nighttime, with real darkness, growing up or throughout your life. Kids aren't having that experience these days. We have 8 out of 10 kids. This was one of the things I found in the book. 8 out of 10 kids born in the U.S. now, today, will never live where they can see the Milky Way. And that used to be a common, it's hard to believe, but it used to be a fairly common sight over towns and cities in the States. I'll show you some really startling images of the growth of light pollution. I was really lucky. I grew up in outside Minneapolis, and my family has a cabin up north in the northern part of the state. And I grew up going to this cabin quite a bit, and especially when I was a child and growing up, the darkness there was nearly complete. And so I grew up with the Milky Way across the lake, across the sky, and I grew up with shooting stars and being out in the woods where it's so dark you can't see your hands, you know, in front of your face, and the sound of loons and wolves even, and just nighttime was alive and beautiful, and that really became part of me. And then I've had some once-in-a-lifetime experiences as well, and I like to read about one of those because it really was a special experience. The most beautiful starry night I've ever seen was more than 20 years ago when I was backpacking through Europe as an 18-year-old high school graduate. I fudged the years a little bit. I don't know if anybody could tell that. I had traveled south from Spain into Morocco, and from there south to the Atlas Mountains at the edge of the Sahara, to a place where nomadic tribes came in from the desert to barter and trade. A place that when I look on a map, I can no longer find. One night in a youth hostel that was more like a stable, I woke and walked out into a snowstorm. But it wasn't the snow I was used to in Minnesota or anywhere else I'd been. Standing bare chest to cool nights, wearing flip-flops and shorts, I let a storm of stars swirl around me. I remember no light pollution. I remember no lights. But I remember the light around me, the sense of being lit by starlight, that I could see the ground to which the stars seemed to be floating down. I saw the sky that night in three dimensions. The sky had depth, some stars seemingly close, some much farther away. The Milky Way is so well defined, it had what astronomers call structure, that sense of its twisting depths. I remember stars from one horizon to the other, stars stranger in their numbers than the wooden cart full of severed goat heads I'd seen that morning, or the poverty of the rag-clad children that afternoon, making a night sky so plush it still seems like a dream. So much was right about that night. It was a time of my life when I was every day experiencing something new. And I felt open to everything, as though I were made of clay and the world was imprinting upon me its breathtaking beauty. Standing nearly naked under that Moroccan sky, skin against the air, the dark, the stars, the night pressed its impression, and my lifelong connection was sealed. I have not ever seen a night quite like that since, which is interesting because I went looking for it in this book. I've seen some wonderful nights, and I'll show you a couple pictures at the end of what I saw, but those are pretty rare and increasingly so. Let me show you some images. Kim, if you want to... I always like to begin with a couple images that, for me, go back to this point I was making earlier about being a child. This is the night that I grew up with, the Milky Way and pine trees, or the full moon on lake water. This is, when I think of what natural night is, this is what I think of. I think of paddling out into the middle of the lake in the canoe and lying on my back on the bow and just watching the universe. Breathtaking, really amazing. But we have by and large lost that experience, especially for our young people. And the reason is what you see here, which is artificial light at night. Not only that though, I want to be clear that artificial light is good and we're going to have it. So the question is how we're using it and how much of it we're using, right? So this is a great example. This is actually a picture taken in the Arboretum at James Madison University where I'm working. And it is of a what we call unshielded light, meaning the shield is, the light is allowed to go in all directions. So a good example of light that's glaring into your eyes and shining in all directions. Again, from the Arboretum. So this natural area lit up with these obnoxious lights at night. We have a lot of light like this, which light that is uplighting is what we call it. You can see some of the light going straight up, not even really hitting the billboard that it's intended to. And then the rest of this is hitting it and then bouncing off and going up into the sky. Even worse, actually, though, is horizontal lighting that's unshielded. So this kind of thing here. These are called wall packs. And they're ostensibly to light the parking lot here. But you can tell if you were taking this picture, you would be all lit up as well. You can see the light is coming right across the street here and lighting you up. And horizontal light will go as for a long way and contribute to light pollution. You may have seen this image. I always, every time I see it, I'm struck by the beauty of it. It really is quite amazing. It's a compilation of satellite photographs. There were no clouds in the sky anywhere. It's kind of interesting. Light at night, artificial light at night even, can be really quite beautiful. And that's, I want to make sure that I emphasize that point. I'm not here to say, let's not have any lights at night. That's not the message. The message is, let's have light, but let's use it thoughtfully, intelligently, responsibly, rather than the opposite of that. So first off, light at night, quite beautiful, but that said, this is an image of waste. This is almost all this light that we see here is either going straight up in the air or shining off the ground, reflecting off the ground into the sky. This is a pretty, one of the interesting things here. Do you know, does anybody know what this is? Up here in the, fracking in North Dakota, the flaring of the natural gas that they're doing 24 hours a day. You can see it from space. One thing worth noticing is what we have out here in the West, which is, and we'll see more of this, but you can really see how the country divides. When we talk about light pollution, three main terms for you to know. The first one is glare. We've already seen a little bit of this. Light that's unshielded, it's going in all directions. This is actually in, let me pause for a second. Does anybody recognize this? You'd have to really know it, but it's up in Tres Piedras. So I was staying at the Aldo Leopold house, if anybody knows where that is up there. And this is the post office of Tres Piedras. And out in the middle of nowhere, we have one of these obnoxious glaring streetlights. So. Glare. Second one is what we call light trespass, which is you can see the light from the science building here, the brand new science building that's shining across the street onto the house where students live, and they've hung black curtains in the windows so that they can sleep at night. So light trespass is a very common occurrence in the United States of America, where we're very aware of property rights until nighttime, when our lights can go wherever they want, all over our neighbors' houses and property, right? Light trespass. And then finally, something we call sky glow. This is a wonderful side-by-side image from a suburb in Toronto. On the left, well, let's go first on the right, what it usually looks like, this area above this house here, sky glow, the artificial light shining off the clouds. On the left is actually the exact same view from the exact same place. But it's on a night when they had a power outage. And so one of the folks on the street walked down the street and took a picture of what it would look like if there were no artificial lights. Every town, Albuquerque, Harrisonburg where I live, Minneapolis where I grew up, the same recipe for light pollution. Here are some of the ingredients. Stadium lighting. These are the intramural fields at James Madison. You can see the sky glow wiping out the stars over the mountains there. Street lights, parking lots are a big offender. This is the Target parking lot in Harrisonburg at about 3 o'clock in the morning. One of my students took this picture. Not a single car on the lot. The lights are on bright all night long. And gas stations are another big contributor as well. Parking lots and gas stations are interesting. The estimates are that they are lit 10 times as brightly as they were 20 years ago. So in that short amount of time, we've increased the lighting that much. We're told this is for safety. I'll talk a little bit more about safety and security in a second, but studies have shown that actually what this has mostly to do is that folks who run these kinds of places have found that if they turn up the lights, they'll get more business. That we like light and we're drawn to light. So they've actually documented how the one store on the corner turned up its lights and got more business. So the corner on the store on the kitty corner turned up its lights more brighter. It got more business and kind of back and forth. So. Uh-huh. Here we are in Paris. The thing I wanted to point out here on the right, the LED billboards, the digital billboards. Very bright, really obnoxious in many ways, and showing up all over the place. I forget the exact number, but it's hundreds a month in the U.S., hundreds more of these in the U.S., really spreading. So let's talk a little bit more about the cumulative effect of all these things. And we'll go to Europe for this. Because we tend to think that, sure, the cities are bright, right? We have a lot of lights in cities. They're going to be bright. But if you get out of the cities, it's dark. And it is darker. There's no doubt about that. But it's not, by and large, naturally dark anymore. It's not as dark as it was. About 12 or 15 years ago was, well, it is 15 years ago now. I've been doing this talk for 2 or 3 years. I got to add some years there. A couple of Italian astronomers wanted to show this effect because people kept saying to them, well, you astronomers just have to go somewhere where it's dark. Just get out of the cities. And they wanted to show that that's actually not the case. So they took this data. They took the data from the photographs from space, and they, using computers and colors, that's how an English professor describes it. Computers and colors, they magic. You'll see it in a minute. They made what they called the World Atlas of the Artificial Night Sky Lighting. So they did the whole world showing the actual spread of light pollution. It's essentially an atlas of light pollution. And what I'd like to point out to you is this. Do I have it? No, I guess it died. This area here in Italy, northern Italy, looks like a big valley of darkness. Right. You can see Milan and Paris and Madrid, London, Rome down here. You can see where the cities are. But it looks like, hey, oh, there it is. Maybe it just works on this side. You can see this valley of darkness. When they did their map, though, it showed, actually, it's not really that dark. So you can still see Madrid and Paris, London, Milan. These are the white, hot spots, the brightest areas. But you can see that area of northern Italy is not as, it's not naturally dark anymore. It's not as dark as it used to be. You have to get out into the oceans, really, to get back to natural darkness. No evidence of artificial light at night. So what do some other places look like? This is South America. Got the fishing fleets down here. The Amazon, still quite dark. I've done a few things up in Colombia. Up here, really interesting. What you see in these places is that wherever there is civilization and people, oh, perfect, thanks. You see the same problems. You see the same recipe. You see the same light pollution. So the only places that are dark, are the places where there, by and large, aren't people. Here's our country. Maybe the most amazing thing about this image is that it's almost 20 years old. So the places you see on the East Coast that looks like over in West Virginia, a little bit down here in Mississippi, that area, those are gone. There are no more black areas east in the East, and out West we're losing them rapidly. They did a really interesting thing. They took the data they had was from 97, and they estimated back, and then they estimated forward to show the trajectory of where we've come and where we might be headed. And you can see, I know there's folks in here who remember this, the 1950s. I remember that's when I was a kid growing up in the 70s, and where we're headed is not good. We're growing at about 6% light pollution every year in general. It is one of those things that grows very rapidly, but just slowly enough that we don't really notice it, right? So it's that gas stations and parking lots statistic that I gave you earlier, right? If we could jump back 25 years, we would be surprised at how much darker it is. So that's one way to think about light pollution or to visualize the actual spread. Here's another one. This is an abbreviated version of something called the Bogard scale. This was created by a guy named John Bogard, an amateur astronomer who got tired of younger astronomers saying to him, you gotta come out here, it's so dark. And they would invite him out to some area. He was from New York State. And he would get out there and he would realize that it really wasn't that dark, that they didn't really know what really dark was. So he came up with this scale. It actually goes from 9 to 1. And you can see the brightest areas are 9. Down to 1 naturally dark area with no evidence of artificial light in the sky or on the horizon. A couple things that stand out to me. Number one is that most Americans live most of their lives in level 5 and above. So they rarely or never experience the lower levels. And the other thing is there's debate whether there are any level 1 darknesses left in the lower 48. Some people would argue that I went out with a guy from the National Park Service who measures darkness in the park areas. Some of you may know the National Park Service now has darkness as one of their resources that they're sworn to protect. And so they have a night sky team that goes out and measures the darkness. And he told me that he's taken measurements in more than 200 national park or National Park Service areas, and he's given level 1 to 3 of the 200. And that's in our national park areas, right? So again, that's no light in the sky, no light on the horizon, no evidence of artificial light. I decided to borrow that idea for the end of night. You'll notice if you get a book, don't return it thinking that, you know, they screwed up the chapter order. I do start with chapter 9. I start in Las Vegas and Times Square, and I work my way down to, as I say, some of the darkest places, and I'll show you some of those in just a bit. But I want to point out, the reason I give you the table of contents here is because sometimes people think that light pollution is just an astronomer's problem. That it's too bad there's light in the sky, but we have other big problems. Go somewhere else and look at your stars. I'm here to tell you that it's a problem that affects all of us. All we have to do is look at chapter 6 is all about the effects on the human body of artificial light at night. I'll give you the three main ones that they're finding. The first is that it is contributing to sleep disorders. And sleep disorders are tied to every major disease that we're dealing with, obesity, cancer, diabetes, depression, you name it. Sleep is a big one. I had a number of folks when I was researching the book say that, and I'm already seeing this actually, that the issue of a lack of sleep or what they call short sleep will be in the news more and more and more and tied to these diseases. We'll hear that, and then we'll hear what they'd like to see is it tied to the idea of long light. Some of you may do this. Some of you may have kids who do this. Some of you may have heard of kids who do this, lying awake before they go to bed with staring at their screens.
Yeah.
Right. That is not good. That is, the blue light that's coming out of your screen is not good for us, especially at night. We can talk more about that, but the reason for that is that it stops the production of the hormone melatonin. It just stops it in your body. So I always, when people say, well, what can I do? One thing you can do is sleep in the dark. And if you have a nightlight, have it be a red bulb, because that has less effect than the white bulbs that we normally use. So sleep disorders, stopping the production of melatonin, and the disruption of our circadian rhythms, those 24-hour rhythms that orchestrate our body's health. So it's really, it's all this light that we're exposed to at night is confusing our body's health. It's also confusing the health of everything else, all the other creatures, right? One of the things that I learned writing the book that really stays with me is the idea that life on Earth evolved with bright days. We need light and dark nights. We need darkness as well. Right? We need darkness for our physical health. Chapter 5, the environment, ecology, needs darkness in a big way. We have 2/3 of invertebrates are nocturnal. Many more are crepuscular. They're active at dawn and dusk. I'll show you a slide in a second that points some of this out. I like to say in the book that the wild world comes alive at night, and it's really true, those of you who've been out at night and know what is going on. When we flood their light with their night with artificial light, it really takes a toll. Number 4, one last chapter I'll point out, maybe my favorite chapter, is about the impact to our spiritual life of all this light. And the subtitle of the book, which I really can't remember right now, but it has something to do with searching for natural darkness, yes, in an age of artificial light. The idea there that artificial light, both literal but metaphorical as well, that we're afraid of the dark in many ways. When you start to learn about traditional cultures, mythologies, you learn that they all had the myth of the hero experience darkness. They had to go to the underworld. They had to go to the dark forest. They had to go someplace where it was dark, because they knew darkness was part of what it means to be a whole human being. We all experience darkness. So this don't worry, be happy society that we live in, there are costs to that as well. Some percentage of animals that are nocturnal, bats. You've heard about maybe sea turtles that have evolved to come onto shores to lay their eggs for hundreds of millions of years. When the hatchlings came up out of the sand, they would scurry toward the brightest light on the horizon, which for hundreds of millions of years was the stars and the moon over the ocean. Now it's the condominiums and the streetlights and the hotels the wrong way. So you have sea turtle hatchlings coming up and going the wrong way. You have birds. We have more than 450 species of birds that migrate in North America alone at night, and they're drawn off course. So huge impact on that. I like this slide because, it shows that big bad science building. This is at one of the schools I used to teach at, so I can say that. Shining the light into the woods. Any nocturnal animal that was using this wood is not using it anymore right now. But the thing about it is, we're told we need all this light for safety and security. Even in Harrisonburg, where I live in Virginia, it's a town of about 40,000. It was recently ranked one of the top 10 safest places to live in the United States. When I went to Home Depot to do a little research on the lighting, this is the sign I saw in one of the top 10 safest places to live telling me to buy this light to deter crime and keep my family safe. Light is not the problem, and some light can help us be safer, showing us where to walk, that kind of thing. But too much light, that equation starts to fall apart. And I'll show you some interesting slides about that. Too many of our quote-unquote security lights, or some of my astronomer friends like to call them insecurity lights, are like this. These yard lights, barn lights, pool lights that are going to be shining all over. Those images of glaring lights that I showed you earlier, that's what these are, right? So they're unshielded. The light is going in all direction. The problem with the idea that light at night makes us safer is, well, there's lots of problems. And I would say that it's a complex issue. It's not an easy issue. We too often reduce it to a simple issue, which light is good and darkness is bad. That's not true either. This is an image of a yard in Tucson, Arizona, with a typical, what we'd call security light. It's unshielded, so it is shining in all directions, including into your eye, which is making your pupil shut down. And I love these images because I think you can even feel it even on the slide, right?
Yeah.
I'll show you an image now that's the exact same image. The only difference is that the photographer is going to hold up his hand and shield that light. He's going to mimic what the light would be if we shielded it so that it just goes down where we need it instead of into the sky and into our eyes. But when he does that, then you can see the bad guy in the fence. All right? Let's go back. You can see him kind of. He's there, but not nearly as good. So the effect of this very bright light is to make your pupils constrict so you can't see as well, to cast shadows like this. Maybe worse of all is that it gives the illusion of safety. We think, oh, bright lights, we must be safe. But you can see that's not the case, right? So the idea is this, that in shielding our lights and lighting to cut light pollution, we actually can increase safety, right? So we're reducing the actual lighting, we're increasing safety by making it easier for you to see. We can do that with all sorts of different lights. Here's another image of kind of the equation here. When we have bad unshielded lights, can't see the bad guy, can't see the stars. As we gradually shield them to the point where they're just, the light's just going down, you can see the bad guy and you can see the stars. Same thing over here, right? Softball fields in Flagstaff, Arizona, unshielded light going in all directions. You shield that light, you have all the light going down to the fields. There's actually more light. When they measure the light on the fields, there's more light where we need it now and no light going into the sky. Streetlights in Albuquerque has a number of lights like this. Unique because the lamp itself is up in the fixture and there's no glass in the fixture. So the lighting particles, the light particles, particles can't go anywhere except straight down. Most people don't think about the fact that when most people buy lights, they do so in the day. And so whether you're going to Home Depot or Lowe's or somebody's coming into your office, it's daytime and they sell them to you saying, don't these look great? They look great, the fixture looks great, but at night they don't look so good. So this is the kind of thing that we can do. The effect is really quite nice. You get the light just going straight down, not into your eye. You get streets like this one. This is in Florence, Italy, where you can see all the way down the street because there's no light coming into your eye. So we can talk more about safety and security, about lighting, about what we can do if you like afterwards. But let me talk a little bit more about why I really wrote this book and what really moves me about this issue. And I think that is beautiful. How beautiful night is, and that includes light. Light like this in London at the Houses of Parliament, or in Paris where they've spent the last 30 years relighting the city to create the ambiance that draws people from all over the world. In the book, I tell the story of getting to drive around with the Frenchman whose job it was to orchestrate all the lighting in Paris. And the coolest thing about that is that he had a parking pass in his little French car that allowed him to park anywhere he wanted in Paris. How cool is that? Because he had to be able to like park and look, you know, get out and look at the light. So that was pretty neat. They told me a funny story about lighting Notre Dame, which is that it took them 10 years to relight it. And you can see this, one of the things they did was to make it gradually brighter as you go upward, so it raises your eyes toward heaven. You know, it's darker in the bottom. And the main guy who was in charge of this told me that the priests allowed them to do everything they wanted with the relighting of Notre Dame, except for two things. The lighting designers really wanted to light up the rose window at night from inside, and they didn't want them to do that for some reason. But they also had this great idea for what they called a light bell, and it would be like a strobe light that on the hour, as though it were tolling, would strobe the length of the cathedral, if you can imagine that. So if it was 8 o'clock, it would do eight, you know, things. And they said, the priest said to him, no, this is a cathedral, not a disco. Where's this? This is the slide that I use to talk about how light at night brings us together, right? Romance, warmth, right? Santa Fe, right? Everybody, you guys are like, whatever, Santa Fe. People around the world are like, Santa Fe. I get it. I think this might be my favorite image that I'll share with you. And if you can see the figure in the bottom there, looking out at the Milky Way over the ocean. We've taken what was once one of the most common human experiences, and we've made it one of the most rare of human experiences, and that is walking out your door and coming face to face with the universe. And this image shows that. And I think that we can talk about the monetary cost, which the latest estimates of our overuse and misuse of artificial light at night, $100 billion a year worldwide. We can talk about the implications. We can talk about safety and security. We can talk about human health. We can talk about environmental health. But we can also talk about these intangible costs as well, right? What do we lose when we lose this experience? I think about all the philosophers and astronomers and scientists and spiritual leaders and artists, musicians, writers who are not being inspired these days by this, right? Or think about, on the other hand, throughout time, all of those folks who were inspired by this experience. The cost starts to add up, right? Think about all the young Van Goghs out there, for example, who are not painting A Starry Night. This is interesting. We all know this painting. Notice the gas lamps in the houses down there. No electric light in Arles in 1888. So just gas lighting in the houses. Something we might talk about, we can talk about a little bit more, is the evolution of artificial lighting from oil lamps to gas lamps to electric lighting, which we know now, and now we're moving to electronic lighting. You might notice all the new LED lights that are going up, both promise and peril with that. A friend of mine who's an astronomer, works at the McDonald Observatory in Texas, decided to update this painting for us, imagining what Van Gogh might paint if he were alive today. Photoshop. Van Gogh has a number of really beautiful night sky paintings, and he writes about, if you know Van Gogh, you know that he wrote so many letters to his brother and to others. For me, it's remarkable to read his letters from Paris, where he talks about the colors of the stars over Paris, which you can't even see the stars over Paris now, let alone the colors of the stars. You can see some, but no colors for sure. Anyway, I love this painting, The Night Sky Over the Rhone. I love it because it's beautiful. I love it because of the story behind it, that if you can see the Big Dipper from Ursa Major up in the top there, it actually wasn't there that night, which I love. That Van Gogh just decided to, it was behind him that night, so he just put it, artistic license. I, for the book, I went to Arles in the south of France. You can go down there. You can go to the spot where Van Gogh stood to paint this painting. And so I was excited to do that. Waited until it got dark and went out there. They have a poster there that shows the spot, and here it is. So you get there, you can't see anything because you're so blinded by the lights. But there's the poster. It says, "On this spot, Van Gogh painted it." I'll stop with a, end with a couple beautiful images of night sky. This is a photograph that my friend Dan DeRisco from the Park Service took on the night that he and I were in Death Valley together. And this is from Death Valley. And I love this photograph because this is what it looked like. Sometimes you see these photographs of night, the night sky, and it's like too amazing, right? It just, I've never seen anything like that. This is really what I remember it looking like, which is amazing, right? And it was one of those nights, I hope you've had this experience, standing in the desert, facing north, watching the stars rise out of the horizon in the east and fall off the edge of the earth on the west. You could, I mean, you felt like the sky was doing this as you were, I mean, I'll never forget that. Amazing. But notice here too, I'm gonna drag anything. Lower right hand corner here, the glow.
Cities.
Las Vegas. Yep. So even though it was a wonderful, beautiful night, and I highly encourage getting out to experience that, it's still not a one. It's still not a level one for what's that, for what that is worth. But here is a one. This is also Death Valley. This is the racetrack in Death Valley. Another shot, this is by Dan DeRisco, the guy I was just talking about. This is one of those three spots that he ranked a level one. So I'll close with a short reading, and then I'm happy to answer questions. Let me also close by again thanking you for being here and thanking the Alumni Association for bringing me back. I never thought I'd be standing here. Our sun is one star in a disc-shaped swarm of several hundred billion stars, writes astronomer Chet Ramo. That disc-shaped swarm is our Milky Way galaxy, and what arcs in three dimensions above this dark Nevada desert is the outer arm of that spiral toward which we look from our inner galaxy location. Ramo continues, "I have often constructed a model of the Milky Way galaxy on a classroom floor by pouring a box of salt in a pinwheel pattern. The demonstration is impressive, but the scale is wrong. If a grain of salt were to accurately represent a typical star, then the separate grains should be thousands of feet apart. A numerically and dimensionally precise model of the galaxy would require 10,000 boxes of salt scattered in a flat circle larger than the cross-section of the Earth. This means that every star in our night sky, every individual star any human has ever seen with his or her naked eye, is part of our galaxy and its several hundred billion stars. Outside our galaxy exist innumerable other galaxies. One recent estimate put the number at 500 billion. At some quick point, the size of the universe becomes overwhelming, its distances and numbers bending our brains as we try to comprehend the incomprehensible, that our night sky is but one tiny plot in a glowing garden too big to imagine. But of course, for all of human history, we have indeed imagined. Ancient civilizations from North America, Australia, South America, created constellations not only from groups of individual stars, but even from the black shapes made by the gas and dust that lie between Earth and our view of the Milky Way's smoke-like stream. And for ages, we imagined it might well be smoke or steam or even milk. Not until 1609 did Galileo's telescope confirm what he suspected, that the Milky Way's glow was the gathered light of countless stars. In these countless stars and their clusters and colors and constellations, in the shooting showers of blazing dust and ice, we have always found beauty. And in this beauty, the overwhelming size of the universe has seemed less ominous, Earth's own beauty more incredible. If indeed the numbers and distances of the night sky are so large that they become nearly meaningless, then let us find the meaning under our feet. There is no other place to go. The night sky makes this clear. So let us go dark. Thank you. Sure, okay. Yeah, yes, sir.
What is the impact of a full moon on the 9-to-1 scale and versus a dark sky?
Oh, that's a good question.
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah, what's the impact of a full moon on the 9-to-1 scale? You know, I don't really know in terms of the number, but I do know astronomers really don't like the moon. They've long since learned everything they need to know about it. One thing to know about the moon, which is really worth knowing, is that moonlight, candlelight, firelight, any natural light doesn't have any of those negative physical human health effects. That natural light is fine. It's just the artificial light that's not good for us. So, yeah, I'm all for moonlight. Yes, ma'am.
But many people have trouble sleeping when the moon is bright.
Right? Many people have trouble sleeping when the moon is bright. This is true. Yes, sir.
To what extent do police departments, cities, and so on embrace or not embrace some of these ideas about light from the standpoint of security?
Yeah. The police are, in general, like the rest of us. Some people understand it. We have I write about this in the book. The Wake Forest University police chief, I was at Wake Forest when I was finishing the book, was very enlightened about this issue and really understood the things that I was talking about. But a lot of folks in the police force are have never heard of any of this. And so, for example, if you go on the website of the suburb where my parents live in Minneapolis, the first thing you can do for safety is light up your house. It doesn't make sense. They haven't heard my presentation, I guess. In terms of towns, lots of towns are embracing it. New Mexico actually has a statewide ordinance when it comes to lighting, which is good. Lots of towns have lighting ordinances on the community level. The country of France has a countrywide level. So it is possible, and places are doing it. If you're interested in finding out more about how to do it or where it's happening, the best place to go is the International Dark Sky Association, darksky.org. a very informative site that talks about how to go about doing this. So it can be done. And the big driver for a lot of places for it is the energy savings. So it's, you're not going to convince elected officials to do anything because of the beauty of the night sky, but you might if you say it'll cut your energy costs, which we can do that. So
New Mexico has a state ordinance. How can like Home Depot and Lowe's and all those places sell those high private security guns?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what they sell here, actually. They might be different.
Question.
Oh, sorry. If New Mexico has a statewide ordinance, how can Home Depot and Lowe's sell lights that contribute to the problem, unshielded lights? And I don't know if they do. They probably do. I don't know. You know, I mean, it's, as you all know, it's one thing to have a statewide ordinance. It's another to have it enforced. I see good signs here in Albuquerque. I see a lot of shielded lighting, which is so somebody's paying attention to it.
Sandia Casino.
Yeah, those electronic billboards are not too good, but it's a start. It's a start. Yeah.
Darkest place in New Mexico, and what number?
There are lots of dark places in New Mexico. One of the neat things that the International Dark Sky Association is doing is creating what they call dark sky places, and awarding them this award as a way to call attention to dark places. And there's a state park up on the way. Sorry, it's not Raton, but it's there's a state park up in that area that just got an award.
Well, the
Gila, yeah, Gila's is good and dark, but there's another one, isn't there, up to Lake Clayton Lake. Anyway, New Mexico is rich with darkness, but if we don't pay attention to the lighting, eventually it's going to fade.
So Death Valley is one of the number one skies. Do you remember where the other two places are?
Southern Utah is what he said. Yes, sir.
Has there been any local governments that have gone so far as to subsidize individuals who want to modify their lights?
It's a good question. Are there any local governments that have subsidized individuals to change the lights? I don't know of any. That's a good question. Lighting technology is changing all the time. It's a very dynamic situation. I mentioned LEDs. A lot of the LEDs that have been going in are troubling to biologists, especially because they're very rich in, they have a lot of blue-rich white light. They have a lot of light that's from the blue spectrum, blue part of the spectrum, which is not the kind of light we want to be seeing at night. And if we have a lot of LEDs that do that, and LEDs can be brighter as well, it could make everything worse. Or if we start to use the capabilities LEDs have to be programmed, to be lowered and raised, depending on the time of the day and that kind of thing, it could really improve the situation. So Albuquerque could have all their streetlights on a laptop, and they would, at 3 a.m, they would be lower. Right? Or parking lot would be dark until somebody walked into it, and then the lights would come on. We have that technology. We can do that kind of thing. We just have to start, number one, becoming aware of this issue and this problem. Yes, sir.
Talk a little bit about any thoughts on the impact about northern lights, the northern lights in Alaska.
Yeah, I don't. The impact of northern lights. Are you thinking of anything in particular, or?
Well, just if they're sort of a trend, or if it's an anomaly. People see more often, less often.
Yeah, interesting question. Northern lights. I don't know a lot about northern lights, but I do know they're on an 11. I believe this is right, an 11-year cycle. It's based on the sun's activity, and so they kind of know when they're going to be more active and less active, and they can you know, depending on what's happening in the sun, they can tell that kind of thing. So if you've never seen them, I highly encourage you to see them. They're pretty amazing. Yes, ma'am.
Anyone that lives in an area where they can see the auroras also are living in an area where it doesn't really get dark at night, so they've all got blackout shades anyway.
That could be. That could be. Yep. A lot of, yeah. I mean, the idea of blackout curtains, it raises an interesting issue, which is whose responsibility is it? Is it up to us to just all buy blackout curtains or drive, you know, somewhere to see the stars? Or is it somebody else's responsibility to light responsibly, right? Yeah.
Do you know if anybody in a decision-making capacity on this campus knows about the knowledge of one of UNM's own graduates? Use what you could offer.
I don't know. I don't know that. Now that, yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's an interesting question. I mean, you know, one of the things that I find compelling, and I'm actually teaching a course this semester at James Madison with a colleague who's in astronomy, and we have a group of students, and we take them out onto the campus, and we ask them, given the idea that while you're at university, everything you're doing is part of your education, so the way you eat, what you do in your free time, et cetera, and it's not just in the classes. What lessons are you learning about nighttime on campus? Right. You can't see the night sky because there's too much lighting. There are blue light, the blue light system is everywhere, which has been argued by the pros and cons of that. Some people would say the message there is be afraid. In general, night on our campuses are like night in our cities. They're lit up way more than they need to. They're designed to make you feel afraid. It's not anywhere you want to be, which I think is really sad. So we're sending people out of university with the wrong message, I think.
Tell us about the new book you're writing right now.
Ah. Thanks, Kim. I just actually sent the new book into the editor today and then celebrated with green chili. So it's about our relationship with the ground at our feet. And it takes a lot of the same themes from the end of night, which is our separation from the natural worlds. And I begin with the idea that, the fact that we live 90%+ of our time inside now. And then when we walk outside, most of us walk on concrete, and we are literally separated from the natural ground, which has ramifications. But even more than that, it's really symbolic of our separation from the ground that gives us our food, our water, our energy, our spirit. So I got to travel to some really fascinating places. You can imagine, I went to Gettysburg right off the bat to talk about hallowed ground. I went to Treblinka and Auschwitz in Poland. How do you make sense of being on, Treblinka is in eastern Poland. I don't know if anybody's been there, but it's essentially a clearing in a forest where the Nazis had a death camp where they murdered 900,000 people in 13 months. And there's nothing there now, basically. It's just, and so how do you make sense of being on that ground? Iowa, paved with corn. It's a really fast, and of course, you know, just lots of interesting places to go to. So I'm excited to have it come out and to be back here in a few years talking about the ground. So thanks. Thank you very much.